The Indian Machine Tool Manufacturers Association, IMTMA, providing the cutting edge to India's machine tool industry. IMTMA was formed in 1946 with a vision of providing a one-stop impetus for the machine tool industry in India, spearheading India into the forefront of industrial revolution by providing a platform for symbiotic industry growth and innovation-led machine tool technologies. What's more, IMTMA has today become a center of excellence for focused application-based training.
Welcome everybody to the online training programs from IMTMA. A very quick overview about IMTMA. The full form of IMTMA is Indian Machine Tool Manufacturers Association. We were set up in the year 1946 as a machine tool member organization. Today we have close to 470 plus members, and we take up multiple activities which include government advocacy on behalf of the members. We conduct a number of corporate training programs. We organize the IMTEX Machine Tool Expo annually. And besides that, we conduct a lot of training programs where we are focused on enhancing the competitiveness in manufacturing. We have conducted over 126,000 plus man days of training so far, with a portfolio of 200 plus standard training programs. Over 4,500 companies whom we have trained till date, and with a participation of over 32,000 professionals so far. Our technology center in Bangalore and the technology center in Pune, and each of these facilities are fully equipped with all the requisite machinery, metrology equipment, accessories, automation lab with robot, and is completely industry 4.0 ready. We deliver our training programs in four different ways: short-term programs, in-house programs, e-learning, and long-term courses meant for young graduate engineers. Our classroom training programs are delivered by experts who have experience in excess of 30 years, with a blend of theory and hands-on training wherever possible. We supplement the programs with demonstration of live machinery or industry visits wherever possible. And we encourage a healthy interaction between the participants and the faculty through the program. Our e-learning initiative is delivered through an exclusive e-learning portal, and the current portfolio is about 10 programs which can be accessed by the participants at their own flexibility during the license period. And the entire program can be taken at their own convenience and flexibility, with assessment, evaluation, and certification being provided through the e-learning platform itself. Ever since April 2020, we have come up with the online training initiative, and till date we have completed over 300 programs, addressed over 15,000 participants, and we have made these programs easily accessible to various types of participants, which can be taken up at a minimum training budget. And we enable live instructor-led programs with interactive question and answer sessions, polling, chat box, and we also provide live demos wherever possible during these training programs. Long-term programs are primarily meant for young graduates who wish to improve their employability prospects by taking up a few programs on design, production, automation, FEA, and these programs are available in long-term mode for young engineers. We thank you. Please visit our website, imtmaelearn.in and imtmatraining.com.
So this is the like a introduction, because when we say servo control for motion, servo technology for motion control, essentially I always found it is necessary to first of all bring into in front of us what are the requirements first of all in motion, because many times we are not fully clear as to what is required for the application or by the customer machine what he wants. So this is like a very fundamental level thing what I am selecting. Requirements in motion control, I'll give some of the specific requirements, and let me tell that this is not like a exhaustive list. You can always add to whatever you feel is not covered here. You are most welcome to add to this. So this is at a glance when we say motion control. So what are the things? Again, let me repeat that this is not all exhaustive. You can always add something, but I just put some of the points here. So you can see here, let us start from programmability. The motion has to be programmable. Positioning accuracy, which is highly important in most of the applications nowadays. Precision, speed control and range. Control over force, torque, synchronized motion of multiple axes. Short duration, overload handling. No uncontrolled motion. Then any effect of external conditions. Efficiency, inching, stroke, frequent start stop, servo lock, programmable acceleration, deceleration, butting against stopper, and force or torque capacity. These are the normally like a usage point of view or technology point of view. These are the points covered. And then let us come to the costing portion, the initial cost and running cost. This also is important because whenever you select any particular drive, then finally the customer, who is the user, has to pay for this. He has to pay for the initial cost and he has to keep on paying for the running cost. So this also has to be necessarily looked into by the automation designer or the machine designer as to the costing of this compared to any other kind of drives. Now, we'll come back to some specifics. When you say motion, it can be easily represented like a graphical thing where x-axis is the time and y-axis is the speed. So I give an illustrative example of speed keeps on increasing from zero speed, it keeps on increasing, goes to certain speed and it becomes steady. Now this is very easy to understand, but the purpose of this slide making is to sort of highlight that for any motion, three things are important. One is the direction of motion, speed of motion, what is velocity of that motion, the value, and how much distance needs to be controlled or to be achieved. So these three things are normally pertaining or associated with any motion control. Now, one important thing to be remembered here is, I have mentioned here in the white color here, distance covered, the area covered by the graph. That means the x-axis multiplied by the y-axis is the area covered of the graph. So that is the distance covered. That means speed into time is the distance. Now, you may feel that it is so obvious why it is required. But when you go to the, at the appropriate time, when you go for servo sizing selection, these simple things also become very important. So that is like a revision. Next is similar graph, but now I am highlighting here that the speed is increasing, then the speed is becoming steady and the speed is decreasing. So the importance of this particular slide, what you can see on the screen is acceleration time, which is in the pink color, and deceleration time, which is in the green color. Now the thing is, each of this, the acceleration, deceleration time, will have some significance on the type of motion I am going to achieve. And then to be remembered is the total distance. Now I am dividing the total distance traverse. I am dividing into three zones: the acceleration traverse distance, the steady speed traverse distance, and deceleration traverse distance. These become important thing when you go for the servo sizing selection. Another thing is these are controllable. Earlier also, see, there will be no motion without acceleration deceleration. There has to be always acceleration deceleration. But earlier we were never sort of looking into this acceleration deceleration time, because as it is, they are small. But what happens is nowadays the machines are becoming very high speed machines. The cycle times are becoming more and more shorter and shorter because of the customer demands. Then what happens is when the cycle time itself becomes less, the distance traverse time itself becomes less, then this acceleration deceleration times are no more negligible. They are significant with respect to the total time available. So those are to be studied in detail. They will have some significance on the calculations. That is the main thing. The force transmission is pertaining to linear motion. torque transmission is for rotary motion. Then the power, which is a universal concept, the power in case of linear motion is force, there is a linear force into linear speed, and the same power for a rotary motion is rotary torque into rotary speed. So power is essentially time rate of doing work. Motion conversion, most of the time the actual application on the machines, whatever the actual thing finally happening on the machine, in most of the time it is linear, something moving forward, reverse, indexing, or something like that, or keep on moving in the same direction. But the available motion at the beginning is normally rotary because it is coming from motor. It can be induction motor, or it can be some other motor, it can be servo motor, it can be even hydraulic motor. So the thing is, the motion source is normally a rotary source, whereas the motion required onto the machine final application is linear. So they have to be converted. So motion conversion, how we do, how efficiently we do, what are the different mechanisms and methods for employing this, itself is a motion control requirement. It has to be understood and designed properly. Positioning accuracy, I think this is simple to understand. Then when I give a particular command, let us say move by say 150 millimeter, that 150 millimeter is like a target destination distance. Within how much accuracy, plus minus, it is actually stopping, is called as positioning accuracy. So depending on the application, the accuracy may be very critical or it may not be critical, sometimes not important at all. The application will decide. Now this is very interesting. I've shown here a blue color block here. And from the top side, there is a pink color arrow called as holding force. And from the left side, there is another brown color arrow called as destabilizing force. And the heading given, you can see at the bottom, I have written is position holding against destabilizing force. So you may not immediately appreciate what is this slide, what it is supposed to be doing, because the job is not moving. When I said holding, it is something holding against the motion, it's not moving. So when there is no motion at all, then what is significance of this? So to highlight this, I'll give a simple, our day-to-day example, then this will be easily clear to all of us. That suppose you have got a sealed water bottle, everybody, a day-to-day affair, everybody uses water bottles every time. Suppose you take a bottle which is sealed and you want to open the seal and use only one hand. Suppose you are allowed to use only one hand, then it is practically impossible. You cannot open that bottle just with one hand, because what will happen is as your fingers will start rotating the lid of the bottle, the bottle itself will start rotating. So it is necessary that if you want to open the bottle, means open the lid of the bottle, then by other hand you have to must hold the bottle. You must grip the bottle. If you grip the bottle, then only the, say, right hand, if you are using for uncorking or unscrewing, then that will exert the opening torque. Without holding torque coming from the left hand, the right hand merely giving a torque for opening is of no use. Torque will not get developed at all. So for opening torque to get developed, the left hand, which is preventing the rotation of the rotation of the bottle, is equally important, but which is normally not realized. We normally tend to automatically assume that motion means something moving. But motion also means something is not moving. Preventing motion itself is a motion requirement. So this is the significance of this. Now, engineering example, if I have to come back to, suppose you want to drill a piece of a, take a steel block and do drilling, take a drilling machine, vertical drilling machine, and put the job below the spindle and below the drill, but don't tighten it to machine base, or don't put any fixture, don't put any vise, and just bring the thing down, that is the drilling machine drill down, the job will not work. Drilling will not happen. The drill will break or the job will fly away. To hold it properly, you require a strong vise which is fitted to the machine base. Then only the drilling will happen. So that is the meaning of this. Frequent start, stop, frequent reversals. This will be not immediately coming into picture, because for most of the automated machines, there is nothing like a frequent start stop. The machine, once you put in the cycle, anyway keeps on continuing uninterruptedly. So where is the question of frequent start stops or frequent reversal? This will be required in two occasions. One is during commissioning the machine. During commissioning, there you have to do many times start stop or frequent reversal, number one. Number two, at your customer side, when the machine is being utilized by the user, suppose there is a maintenance breakdown, the machine has to be set right properly, then that is another sort of occasion when this start stop will be frequently used. So the significance of showing this slide is, if you try to do this with a normal easy level with 3-phase induction motor, if you keep on doing frequent starts of the motor will start tripping. That means the overload relay or the fuse, whatever protective circuitry you have put there, it's all tripping because every time the motor is started, it draws huge amount of current from the supply. It can draw easily up to 8 times its rated current. And then if you keep on doing frequently or reversing, then that current will make the protective circuitry, the fuse or overload relay, quite hot, it will start, or MCB quite, it will start tripping. So that can be nuisance if doing my maintenance, I want this kind of motion. Then other thing is, as a requirement of motion is braking for the purpose of sudden stopping. And second is braking for the purpose of position holding in absence of power. So these two are different. Now braking for the purpose of sudden stopping, I will once again go back to a simple example, not an engineering example. Suppose you are driving a four-wheeler, you go in front of your house and park the car. Normally, when you get down from the car, you are supposed to put the car in the first gear and also put a handbrake so that when you get down, the car will be like a rock steady, it will not move at all. But due to whatsoever reason, either negligence or your mind was occupied some other place, you get on from the car by putting in the neutral and don't put handbrake also. And unfortunately, suppose the car where it is parked, that is having a slope, the ground is having a slope, then what will happen is slowly the car will start automatically getting, start sliding down the slope, and it may pick up speed and it can cause a major accident. So this is the second one I'm telling now. So it has to be braked. The braking is done by the handbrake as well as putting in the gear, where the engine itself will work as a brake. So this is the second one. Now, first, it's very easy to understand. Sudden stopping is, suppose the same car you are driving and you are able to see that within some distance, let us say 60, 70 meters away from you, a person is trying to cross the road. And if you don't reduce the speed, you are sure that you will hit the man. So definitely you'll put down the brake and you will ensure that there is no accident. The car will come to stop, or it will, the man would have crossed and gone before you go near the spot. So that is sudden braking whenever it is required. So these two are different brakings. So this is to be understood. Now the significance of this on the machinery application, whatever machines you will be having in mind, both are required. At places, both will be required. So that has to be seen from application to application. Programmability of motion is very fairly simple, because today there cannot be any motion unless it's programmable. The only thing to be understood here, why I made this slide, is many times I found the programmability of motion, the people who build the machine, and particularly people who use the motion control drives, various drives are there. It can be electromechanical, it can be hydraulic, it can be servo drive, stepper motor drive, and there will be a PLC to drive all these things. So the commissioning engineer will do the programming, but he might not realize that he, as his company is manufacturing machine, they are not users of machine. The user of machine is somebody different. Somebody is paying to your company for buying the machine. So those are the users. So programmability has to be seen from the point of view of the user. How is the user is going to make the machine to work as per his requirement? That kind of programmability has to be understood when the machine is built up. If that is, that clarity and customer thinking is not there, then the programmability, even though it is there, it will not be, this will not be a proper solution from the customer point of view. Motion relation between multiple axes. Not that every time is required, but there will be many occasions where there are multiple number of shafts on a given equipment. The shafts have to rotate with synchronism with each other. The synchronism can be either only speed synchronization, or it can be speed and position synchronization. Both are possible depending on the requirement. So this can be a possible motion requirement. Overload handling, means when you are making a particular machine as per certain specification, you have to necessarily design the entire machine while designing the machine in terms of the all the power ratings of various manufactured parts, bought out parts. And when you commission the machine, you have to ensure that there is some amount of overload handling is possible. Otherwise, the machine will start tripping each and every time you slightly overload, and that will be nuisance for the customer. Next is speed control from very low to very very big speed. So this I'll be explaining in some of the example approach. So this for timing, you can skip. Jerkless starting. Anything, any motion when you start, whatever I shown here, the blue graph you can see, the speed is this is a programmed speed. The speed is supposed to go on increasing like this and then become steady. But this is what is the command or this what is the requirement. But in reality, the speed will not match with this. The speed in reality, the speed will be this dotted green line. It will keep on increasing, slightly delayed with respect to program time, and then it will overshoot. Then it will undershoot, again it will overshoot, then after some time it will stabilize. If this kind of motion is there, that is called a jerky start. But same thing, I can, with my control parameters and the overall system design, I can make it smoother, that means it will not overshoot. It will go and simply sort of merge with the required speed. There will be always some difference with respect to the program and my achieving time. The time is called as response time, that can never be made zero. None of the things can will have zero response time. Everything will have some specific response time of the item or the system that has to be accepted. But taking that into account, you can see what is the best you can do for the application. This is similar extension, jerkless stopping. Jerkless stopping, you can easily make out. Suppose you are traveling in a train, and sometimes the train will come to stop so smoothly that you won't realize. Suppose you are keeping your eyes closed, you won't even realize whether the train was moving and it has stopped or it is still continuing. Whereas suppose you are moving in a bus and the bus driver suddenly puts a brake, then you will go and hit the next bar. So this is the jerk. This has to be avoided onto the machine design motions as much as possible. Engine facility is moving very short, small distances. They can be programmed distances or they can be programmed speed. As long as you're holding the button and keep on moving, that is programmed speed. Or the speed is pre-programmed, but the distance can be as long as you press the button, it will step the movement as per your requirement. So the both can be required motions at times. This is not very frequently required, but once in a while it will be required. So you can take it as a new knowledge if you're not aware of this. Stopping of circular motion on machine at a predefined specific oriented position. Now, if you are starting a linear motion, you are starting the linear motion from a given starting point, initial point, and then you give a command, say, let us 300 millimeter. The 300 millimeter is with respect to the starting point. So it will go and stop there. But here it is different. Here it is rotating. So there is nothing like a starting point of rotation. It is already rotating. Something is already rotating. And then you give a command such that what you want is when the stop command is given, I am referring to stop command. When you give stop command, it should stop at a specific angle. Now if you are not much familiar with the machinery application, I'll give a simple example for understanding. Everybody's house, there will be a number of ceiling fans will be there. What you do is go in your room having a ceiling fan, and there will be having three blades. On one of the blades, you put some kind of a marking. You put some marking with some ink or something. And then you go and stand in the corner of the room. Now fan is not rotating. And ask somebody to switch on the fan. After fan picks up speed, then you ask that somebody to switch off the fan. When the fan is switched off, it will take its own time and it will come to rest. Now, what are the chances that when it comes to rest, when the fan stops rotation, the ink marking blade will point out towards you where you are standing. Possibility is not zero. It can be calculated mathematically. Possibility will be very small, it will not be zero. But suppose my requirement is like this, that I want it like this. Nothing like possible or less possibility. No, I want. That means when I'm standing in the corner of the room, whenever the fan is switched off, that blade must stop pointing towards me only, suppose that is your requirement, then you will require some kind of special controller for fan control. Now, same thing happens in the machine applications, that there can be certain applications where a rotary motion, whenever you give a stop command, there is nothing like a when you give, anytime you can give, but when it stops, irrespective of starting time instant or starting position of the rotating portion, irrespective of both of these, if you stop command, whenever it stops, it should stop in a specific particular angle. This is called as, in the technical language, it is called as oriented stop or oriented position stop. Now, important here is stopping should at the same position. There are two things important here. Is with angular accuracy within how much, say plus minus 1 degree, plus minus 0.1 degree, plus minus 5 degrees, what you want is one thing. And second thing is the time for stopping. You can have technology where it takes something like 1 minute without much problem to stop with some technology. But 1 minute can be too much of a time. So your whole cycle itself is say 1 minute. Then you cannot allow 1 minute for stopping the spindle of the machine. It can be maybe hardly 1 second, 2 seconds. So that stopping time and stopping accuracy are the attributes connected with this oriented stop. Force or torque exertion in stall condition. Control of force in physically stalled motion. Now this is something is not easily understood. So let me give a simple example. That you stand near a wall in your office or in your house, stand near a wall and put your hand, say right hand, you put against the wall and then start pressurizing the wall. You put whatever best possible force your body can exert, you put that force. Suppose your body is capable of giving, say, 25 kg, your hand will pressurize the wall by 25 kg. Now, you can observe whether the wall will break. Obviously, wall will not break. 25 kg is nothing compared to strength of the wall. Next is whether your hand will break. Hand will also not break because your brain is strong enough, brain is alert enough to ensure that the hand doesn't break. But at the same time, the 25 kg is passing. Now, next is suppose I want to do that instead of 25 kg, suppose I want to measure how much force I am giving. Just assume I want to measure the force. Can I give only 5 kg? Yes, I can give. Suppose I want to give only 100 gram. Yes, I can give. That means I can give the force as per what my requirement without any damage to the hand or any damage to the wall. This, I think, you can easily visualize. Now, the same thing is required in machinery application, that you should be able to exert force or torque in a stall condition. That means the force is on, torque is on, but there is no movement. Movement is not possible because the other side is like a steady state rock. It cannot move at all. So this is the meaning of this. Position monitoring, either during motion or during standstill, or monitoring the actual position even during absence of power. So these are the things becoming more and more important in today's machines because of various obvious reasons. No uncontrolled movement on the machine. This is a safety kind of thing. Whatever control mechanisms you are putting, whatever motion control dive you are putting onto the machine for the application, it must not have any kind of a uncontrolled movement without operator's command or operator's knowledge. Otherwise, it can be accidental. So this also is a requirement. If this is not looked into, it can cause accident onto the machine. Load behavior should not affect the operational speed. Whatever type of drive you are using, the load on the machine is strictly not in your control. The load will have its own ways of working, its own parameters of working. So load will keep on varying. Because of that load variation, is your operational speed going to change? Because of whatever reason, either you are not selected properly, the capacity or some other control system. Suppose the operational speed keeps on changing, that is not good. So you have to design so that the operational speed does not change irrespective of the load changes, load behavior. So I'll give some of the examples here. And these are specifically for servo controlled motion. Now, unfortunately, out of all the participants, there could be some newcomers for this servo technology. They might not immediately realize the significance of this, but in the introductory session that is like a thing which I have to work like that only. So try to imagine what are the motions possible. That is the idea. So this is called as master slave running. There will be two servo controlled operations. One is defined as axis one, axis two. So anyone you can define as master, the other becomes slave. The purpose is, as written here, motion requirement, axis one. Motion will be controlled motion through external device program, external device or program. Position and instantaneous speed can be changing. Axis two has to exactly follow axis one, maybe with some proportion, including intermittent power failure conditions also. That means if the motion stops because of power failure, then after power is restored, the thing should be maintained. That is the proportional or the synchronization in between the two has to be maintained. This is a requirement. So this is possible with different kind of motion controllers. The most popular is PLC, programmable logic controller. Today many PLCs are available with motion control modules. Intelligent motion modules are there. They work in such a manner that both servo are connected to the motion module, and then the motion module keeps track of the actual position. Every instant the motion module knows what is actually happening for axis one and axis two, and then automatically it corrects the axis two if it is found to be lagging or leading with respect to the desired motion. So the applications of this can be this was like a conceptual thing. The actual applications will be printing, packaging machines with multi shafts, which must have continuous position and speed relation with the main shaft. Interpolation, it is a synchronized motion between two or multiple axes. Now, I mentioned here, there can be linear interpolation or circular interpolation or three axis helical interpolation. The servos can give the basic intelligent command is coming from the PLC, of course, but the servos are working as an intelligent slave. Whatever the slave, whatever the signal it receives, they gets exactly properly executed by the servo level. Because for PLC or motion controller, generating an intelligent signal is not easy. It is not difficult. It is very easy because now so many software instructions are easily available. But the servo must respond. This is the specialty of servo. If you use any other kind of drive, the PLC will give intelligent instruction, but the servo will not respond. So it is a combination of servo and PLC which gives the desired motion. Now I have written here, this is essentially open loop control and having limited accuracy and is not comparable with CNC based interpolation. One axis holding while the other is moving. A few minutes back I told if I want to open the lid of a water bottle, I must hold from one hand, then only I can open. So this is extension of that. Suppose the rotary axis one is servo axis one is a rotary indexing table on which I put some kind of a job. So my requirement is I will index to a certain degree, stop it there, hold the position, and the other slide, which is on the machine base, will come forward and do drilling operation. Now, when the drilling operation is happening onto the job, which is onto the rotary table or the job itself can shake, it can move, then the drill will break. So that has to be prevented. That means when I stop the servo one in the rotary index position, it must hold rigidly. So this is achieved by the phenomenon of servo lock. Now, servo lock, you just hear the name now. When I conduct the actual training program of 3 or 4 hours, that will be covered in detail. So servo lock is a phenomenon which will assist to give this kind of a behavior on the machine. High resolution infeed movement of grinding wheel. The cylindrical grinding machines, the grinding wheel has to go forward or reverse in microns. So that movement is controllable through manual pulse generator or MPG. So that movement is always in microns, 1 micron, 2 micron, 5 micron. So that is becoming the motion requirement, and today servo technology is able to give this. This is gluing or coating machine for non-defined contours. I have shown here a very odd-shaped contour in some like a metal face is there, on which similar shaped some coating material, or let us say rubber gasket, has to be glued here or to be pasted here. So the gluing or the coating material has to be equally spread here properly. So this is possible by a servo, intelligent combination of servo and PLC technology. This two-axis control servo mechanism can hold a gun, and the gun can be rotated without actually gluing. The gun can be rotated over this surface with the help of control push buttons, which are connected to the PLC. The entire surface is something like a profile scanning. If I complete this one revolution, and that movement will have to be necessarily in inches with using my fingers, I have to inch the motion. So whatever inching I'm giving command through my fingers, it is going to the PLC through whatever push buttons or commands, and then the PLC will generate the respective servo motion. So the PLC keeps on understanding for every inching what is the command it is receiving and what is being executed. So when I complete one profile of this surface, the PLC has understood what is the contour, and then it becomes a memory in the PLC. And then the next point, next onwards, the same thing will be automatically done by the PLC. So this is basically a PLC based thing, but the servo, as I told earlier, the servo has to respond, because the movement is extremely small. The movement can be in microns. So unless you use a servo in conjunction with PLC, mere intelligence of the PLC will not be sufficient. This will be probably most of you will be familiar with industrial experience. There can be a pick and place mechanism, positioning mechanism, there is a two-axis mechanism, three-axis mechanism. So this is just a simple example of that. The thing to be additionally looked into or taken care of here is that suppose this, what I've shown here is a gripper. In the gripper, suppose you are having a pneumatic screwdriver. So this is for a threading or bolt tightening application by using this pick mechanism or putting screws. Then when you are tightening that bolt or the screw with this mechanism, a reactionary torque can come onto the entire servo-based mechanism, and then it can shake or it can move. So that has to be taken care and has to be prevented by the phenomenon of servo lock. And the servo sizing menu select, it has to be selected by looking into this possibility that during actual electrical screwdriver mechanism, pneumatic screwdriver, the whole mechanism can shake. That is prevented by the servo sizing servo lock. So this is the meaning. This polygon turning machine, just given some very simple thing to understand here. The pre-machine, this is a cross-section of the job, is a bar, is circular cross-section bar. It has to be turned. It has to be turning. It's not a milling operation. It's a turning operation on a lathe. And the final shape, what I want is like a square. So what is done onto the machine design is the job or the bar will be put into the lathe chuck. It is held, it is made to rotate with a servo motor. The job starts rotating, and then there's a single point tool which will move forward and reverse with respect to the job. And then also there is a cross mechanism for like a feed rate in the whole periphery or diameter of this. So now you can see, if you want to generate a four angled square shape, then for each rotation of this job, this tool should move forward and reverse four times in one revolution of the job. Four times in one revolution of the job in sinusoidal manner. Then only you will get a particular, then you will get this 90 degree surfaces in a square. So it requires a lot of mathematics to be done, and geometry is also involved. So all this is written in the PLC program, motion control drive. And there will be three servos, one for rotation, one for cross movement, and one for the parallel movement. So a combination of all these movements will generate this. So that is the one more application. Force control during friction welding process. Friction welding is a process. I'll just a little bit explain. You can see here the pink color portion and the blue color portion, they are initially separated. They have to be welded to each other. So the pink color portion, suppose there is a rod or a piston that is put into a spindle in a chuck, and that is made to rotate. At that time, this part two, which is on the machine slide, which is held rigidly on the machine slide, then it is slowly brought forward in a linear motion. This does not rotate. The part two blue color does not rotate. It will go and butt here. Then there will be a lot of surface friction between the two surfaces, because one is rotating, other is not rotating. That will generate enough amount of heat, and the temperature of both the jobs will increase. Then they will go to something called as plastic region. From the elastic region, they will go to plastic region. When they go to proper plastic region, then this axial force is suddenly increased, called as upset force. And no, before that, the spindle is stopped. This motion is rotation is stopped, and then I give this offset force. So that is the time or that is instant when the materials will get welded together. The material will get integrated with each other, and you will get a smooth welded joint. So this is the application of this is the meaning of friction welding. Now you look here, this force, axial force F here, it is not simply giving a force. The force has to be given in a specific manner. The x axis can be either time axis or a distance axis. The force has to be initially certain value, constant value. Then the force should keep on steadily increasing. Then it should maintain for some time. And then at certain point of time, the spindle is stopped. And then this F2 is meant to go to F3 suddenly in an instant. So this is the requirement of the force. So this can be generated with a hydraulics, servo hydraulics, or it can be also a servo electrical motor. So this is one more example. Servo press or servo cylinder, where the rotary motion of a servo is converted into linear motion, and we can work like a press. The ram will become up and down and will generate the suitable amount of force. Now facilities the user available means all along normally these are hydraulic technology, but now it is giving way to servos. The facilities to the user, especially compared to hydraulics, fully programmable ram movement, rapid point, feed point, position rate, guaranteed position accuracy in case it is of any usage here, force monitoring through the load cell and intelligent decision making, possibility of programmable force versus displacement by using in torque control mode. Also force can be maintained without actual movement of ram. Ram position force display on the HMI screen. So servo motor working as a load, I'm sure most of you, unless you are in the servo technology already, this will be a new thing to you. Here, what I'm showing here is on the left side, you can see a yellow color test motor. Suppose it is a dynamo of a car, means alternator of the car. It has to be tested. It's an electrical motor. This motor has to be tested for maybe temperature, current, and whatever load it can take. How do you load the motor? You can give the voltage, run into a particular speed. As per voltage speed will change, but that is not loading the motor. For loading the motor, the conventional technology was mechanical brakes. Means brake dynamometers were there, but brake dynamometers is a loss of energy. You waste a lot of energy in heating belt versus the pulley. Now with the servo motor, with the special phenomena called a torque control mode, I can use servo motor as a load. So what I do is connect the motors and the test motor mechanically. I connect. Now I start driving the test motor in a particular direction, but the servo motor is subject to a torque in the opposite direction. So the motor will still get rotated. Now motor is like a load. It will get rotated by the test motor opposite to its command torque. I have given torque, let us say one direction, but the test motor is opposite direction. So the opposite direction torque will be prevailing. So the motor will start getting driven and the motor will start working as a load. For this to work as a load properly, one more mechanism is required. When the motor working as a load here, that means the motor direction, rotation of motor direction, and the torque direction in the same motor, they are opposite. They are not same. In that case, what happens is the motor starts working as a generator. So when the motor starts working as a generator, it will generate electricity. The electricity has to be taken out from the servo amplifier, which is the electronics. And there is a optional accessory called as power regeneration unit. From that, the motor has to be fed back to, the power has to be fed back to the three-phase supply. Unless this is done, this application will not work. Merely voltage generation is not sufficient. You must draw current, then only becomes a load. So this will open up many new possibilities where you can make this thing very simple and programmable without using clumsy or energy wasting type dynamometers. This is another specific interesting example. This is shock absorber testing, spring loaded shock absorber. I've shown here these two positions, A position and B position. A is fully released, spring is fully released, and B is fully compressed spring. So the requirement of this test rig is I start compressing the spring by linear motion. It goes to full end B, it cannot compress anymore. Then I start releasing the spring. So compress and release. Compress and release is the cycle, and maybe the cycle has to be done, say, 1,000,000 times. But the specialty is, the requirement can be something like this. This was one of our actual applications done. The speed of this forward reverse movement, the speed has to be sinusoidal speed with respect to the distance. Now that means from the A to B, from fully released to fully closed, the speed should keep on increasing. Halfway, the speed should keep on reducing. Then B is fully compressed, so there is no more speed. Now the speed should reverse. So this sinusoidal motion, this is possible, or rather this is a requirement of the particular application. Conventionally, this is being done with servo hydraulics. But if the sizing is not big, suppose the tonnage, this is defined is of tonnage, how much tonnage you want to give, how much is the frequency of operation. So if they are not big, then servo motor is also one of the drives for this. Nut runner is a very simple example. Earlier times, nut runner used to be always pneumatic nut runner or hydraulic nut runner. Now slowly, slowly that field is also getting sort of overtaken by the servo motor technology. It will give so many advantages. Running in position more for some time. That means screw just rotating without getting tightened. Running in torque mode for some time, then actual tightening. Running is free mode for short time initially before it touches. Then keeping track of all the time, all the positions. Tightening, torque, setting, and display. These are all possibilities with servo technology. So slowly, slowly, the pneumatic driven nut runners and hydraulic driven nut runners are giving way to servo electrical motors. Comparison between various types of motion control systems. So this is once again the same thing I'm showing, but now the thing is the machine manufacturer or designer has to select adequate and optimum motion control drive for his machine. The following chart gives macro level guidance about which operation points to be looked into, and then compares the performance of various motion control systems for each point. So this chart is personally prepared by me with my experience of all these years. So what I've done here is I've shown, for the purpose of explanation and understanding, I selected six kinds of motion drives. One is a mechanical with industrial motor, induction motor and VFD, mechanical stepper motor, pneumatic, normal oil hydraulic, proportional servo oil hydraulic, and servo electrical motor. So these are the various possibilities of motion control systems. And for that, the performance point can be different. So the thing what I selected first one is positioning accuracy and position repeatability. For this point, how the various drives will compare. So these are the remarks which I have made here. This is my personal sort of experience coming onto you as an experienced chart coming in front of you. Speed control, then you can see, just as an example I'm telling, for speed control setting and running, if you see as a criteria, then the mechanical with VFD, the performance is medium. Mechanical stepper, medium. Pneumatic is very poor. Normal hydraulics is medium. Servo hydraulics is very good. But the best is servo electrical driven, unbeatable compared to any other drive. So this is a way for your requirement of the motion. You have to keep on listing this, and for each of these, you find out to the best of your imagination, discussion, experience, for getting feedback from others, for what is the rating of each kind of drive for each particular point, and then you will start knowing what is the drive to be selected for my given application. So these are the some of the many things I have written here. So this is like a reference. I cannot explain each and everything here. Okay, so now I'll go to my last presentation. This is like a overview of the entire technology. So I'll just read typical special features, motion programmability, customization of proven standard hardware software to suit application through feature of user setable parameters, motion control through position or speed or torque mode. This opens so many application possibilities, high speed positioning, trouble-free execution of extremely small value movement commands, intelligent motions, synchronized motions in conjunction with intelligent motion controllers, wide speed range, trouble-free operation even at extremely low speeds, servo lock automatically holding a position in case of no command signal, practically no limitations on frequency of start stop inching, possibility of on the fly feedback from position, speed, torque, possibility of power feedback to supply through regeneration. Now these are some of the examples where servo technology is already being employed. So this is just a list. Possibly each of you may be able to connect to something at least one or two examples. Metal cutting machines, feed access movements, indexing tables, stepped movement mechanisms, automatic tool changers, tool turrets, polygon turning machines, form fill seal machines, printing machines, packaging machines, synchronized conveyors in automated production shops, remote control setup changes in automated production lines, assembly machines, pharma industry machines, bottling plants, online testing machines, fatigue testing or durability testing or type testing machines, friction welding machines, pick and place mechanisms, gantry mechanisms, presses, motor working as programmable loads, universal testing machines for tension, compression, torque, nut runners, painting, coating, and gluing mechanism. These are the most of these kind of applications today are done with servo technology. Now, a very small glimpse of future of this technology at the technology level. Linear servo motors, up till now I mentioned was rotary servo motors, but linear servo motors are already started coming into the market. Then embedded or integrated packages of motion controllers and servo motors, application specific servo packages, more flexible environmental specifications, means up to what temperature, RH, humidity rating, altitude, all these things, vibration level, these are coming under environmental specifications. Future applications, in addition to present ones, industrial applications, machines, oil hydraulics, pneumatic movements will get replaced by servo motors to a great extent. Faster intelligent remote controlled production lines, more automation in production lines through increasing automatic loading unloading, pick and place mechanisms, automatic assembly and online inspection stations, automated storages, warehouses, vending machines. Now, this is the last presentation. As I mentioned in the beginning only, that although servo is a very powerful technology, but you should be also aware of its limitations, at least limitations as of today. As at present, amongst various kinds of motion control technologies, electromechanical, VFD driven, pneumatic, normal oil hydraulics, servo hydraulics, electrical servo motor technology is still the costliest. This is the harsh fact of the matter, is it is the costliest. So the application should justify usage of servo. Application, if it is properly understood, then you will find servo is the correct optimal solution. Otherwise, you have to make compromises. Hopefully this situation will change in coming years with prices coming down to easy affordable level. Next is, this is a practical, practical thing, it's not technology. It is a shortage of skilled, knowledgeable technical manpower. The manpower available in our country today, compared to the application possibilities, the quantum of applications, the manpower is very much shortage. Manpower's engineers for selecting the proper servo as a solution, schematics, sizing, overall engineering, implementation, software development, everything. Then technology, third point, technology suitable as of now only for indoor applications. It will be properly inside the factory. Need not be air conditioned, but inside the factory. This is unlike three-phase induction motors, which are easily being used even on open fields. There is no limitation at all. So this is the limitation here. Last point is significantly weaker compared to oil hydraulic motion drives, with the criteria of power to weight ratio. Power to weight ratio is a criteria where for a given amount of weight, how much power is transmitted. If you are not able to visualize this, I request you to visualize. Suppose you have seen an oil hydraulic power pack system. Hope you must be aware of oil hydraulic power pack. See the size of motor and the connected hydraulic pump. Suppose both are 3 HP. Then 3 HP motor sizing and the weight, and the weight of 3 HP pump, you will see the motor will be easily 5-6 times bigger and heavier compared to the respective oil hydraulics. Both are conducting 3 HP, both are transmitting 3 HP power only. But the power ratio of hydraulics is much, much better, higher, because of the essential thing that hydraulics, you can operate very high pressures, whereas the current, we cannot go on increasing the current in the motor. So because of this, there will be certain applications where very high torque and very high force are required. Hydraulics will still continue, servo motor will not be able to reach that. Now my presentation is over.